University and all the great partners here hosting this event. I believe we as elected leaders can implement programs and policies that benefit the environment while still helping those in need. An example would be the San Antonio Under One Roof Program. The program installs a high reflectance roof for a home who meets the age requirements, veteran, disability requirements, and income qualifications. These roofs, high reflectance roofs, can have multiple benefits, including reducing energy bills by decreasing air conditioning needs, improving indoor comfort for spaces that are not air conditioned, decreasing roof temperature, which may extend the roof service life. It benefits the environment, especially when the buildings in the community have them, through reducing local air temperatures, also known as the urban heat island effect, as well as reducing air pollution, lower peak electricity demands, and reducing power plant emissions. UTSA, who has tracked the White Roof Program since its inception, has the data to confirm this. CPS Energy even created a rebate program based off of this data. Homeowners who install a roof like this can receive a rebate based on the reflectance rating and the square footage of the home. There are ways to combat the effects of climate change at every level of government. Officials just cannot be afraid to think outside the box and create innovative solutions. Partnerships with local universities like Trinity are essential for creating well-informed climate policy. Furthermore, policy administrators like Doug Melnick play a vital role in San Antonio's climate strategy. I'd like to welcome the director of the city's sustainability office, Doug Melnick, to do his presentation. And no spurs go. So, climate change is a big topic. I was trying to frame this conversation going forward about sort of the background of what this is, why it's something that is important for us to work on, and some of the policy questions that we need to address as a, it's not just as a city, but as a global community. And the thing that's so challenging about this is it isn't something that's easy to solve, and we really need to sort of dig into understanding what led us to this point in time, and that's one of the things I'll be touching on. But first, and I'll go through this really quickly. So, who in the with a show of hands, who believes climate change is happening? Okay, and then who believes it's caused by human activity? Okay, so pretty much now you guys understand it. Skip that one. One of the things, if it was a bigger group, really seeing if as our population grows and changes, our different perspectives coming into the community. And then students, just concerned citizens. Yeah, so I mean, you guys, and I think towards the end we'll talk about what we need you to do as far as helping us with this conversation, because that's really sort of the big thing that needs to happen right now, is making people aware across the community that this isn't just a global issue. It's a local issue, and there's a local role and responsibility that exists. So a little bit about me. I came from the environmental sector, but mostly sort of from field biology.
strong mayor form of government is very different than what we have here. I was the director of planning. We created an energy and sustainability office. And I look at that picture, I really didn't have that much more hair, but there was a little bit more hair. Came to San Antonio, wanted to go to a big city. Don't know if you recognize him, these other two people. John Dugan on the right was the past planning director, and Terry Bellamy was assistant director of transportation and capital improvement. We were sort of the three amigos of the SA Tomorrow plans. I'm proud to say I'm the only one that's still here. And that was really sort of the sort of like trifecta of figuring out how do we manage this growth, the million people coming, additional people in San Antonio by 2040, and what does that mean for our community's long-term sustainability? More housing demands, more economic activity, more cars, and so what do we do to manage that? I've been working on air quality. Non-attainment is potentially just around the corner, although we're sort of still in the throes of discussions internally and externally with EPA. I think it's your guess is as good as mine what's going to happen. It's a real page turner, and I think we'll hopefully know something relatively soon. And then this is what we're working on now. When Mayor Nuremberg came on board last June, first order of business at council was a resolution in support of the Paris Climate Accord. And where we are right now, working with our partners, with the community, different stakeholders, what does a Paris compliant path look like for us? And then it's got the little hat on it for Texas, how do we do it that's going to fit in with San Antonio to make sure it's something that's going to resonate here, but get us where we need to go. So, and you guys probably, some people have seen this before, I don't know, I think it's funny. I'm from New York, upstate, and downstate is a big deal. I grew up in Long Island, that little green part, Suffolk County. But, you know, why did I come here? It was because this was basically, you know, snow's really great, the first snowfall of the year, it's beautiful, everybody goes out, and by the end, everybody's just absolutely miserable, and everybody's just super annoyed. And then this isn't as funny anymore, because when you look at the news, climate patterns are changing. They're still getting hit with snowstorms, and we're in the spring. When you start looking at the scientific findings, they're talking about, well, we're seeing shifts in ocean currents, and we're seeing shifts in jet streams, and everything that we knew about what our climate and weather was is changing. And so, you know, I guess the first question is, you know, is our climate changing? I think we've known for a long time. This is Dr. Arrhenius, who was a scientist who back in 1896 came to the conclusion that as you increase carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, ground level temperatures rise. And then again, if we're watching the news, we continue to see report after report that, yeah, industry knew, major oil companies knew that the burning of fossil fuels contributes to climate change. And so where we are right now is, what do we do with all this information? There's consensus in the academic community. Over 97% of active climate scientists believe that climate change is occurring and it's being caused by human activity. You know, what do we do with that? Because it's a pretty major shift. none of this is necessarily going to be easy or without costs. So how do we balance that moral imperative with, okay, in this day and age, in our political situation, our economic situation, how do we start making those changes? You know, so in terms of the moral imperative, we've seen this. I mean, how many people saw this? It was just gut-wrenching. You know, this is climate change is occurring. We have species that are just being devastated. What responsibility do we have for that? And I think it's a big question. What does San Antonio have to do with the Arctic ecosystem? But again, it's translating. Our actions do have global impact. UNESCO released a study a few years ago that starts looking at, well, what's the impact on these World Heritage Sites as a result of climate change. So this hits things that really are very important to us. And so what are some of our vulnerabilities? We're not immune to wildfire. We are 465 square miles and growing. At that rural-urban interface, we're building, and there's wildfire risk. Vector-borne diseases, as it gets hotter, wanting to get out of the city. And my parents grew up in Brooklyn, and we lived on Long Island, and this is what they did. But you know, if there were issues related to public health or density, or what were the barriers to having folks really flourish in cities, the answer may not have just been to just use this model. Would there have been other models? And it gets down to this whole idea of unintended consequences. I don't think anybody who went down this road with this future development pattern that we're sort of stuck in right now had that as their primary focus was to cause climate change, but it was an unintended consequence. And that's why it's so important as we start developing a plan forward, a path forward, looking at food policies, really asking that question, what is the unintended consequences? And then there's, of course, the idea of consumption. We are a major consumer society, and that is a big component of reducing emissions that lead to continued climate change. And so that gets us to sanitary and our contributions, and sort of the baseline for how we start developing policies going forward. You can see this is the 2014 community emissions inventory. 60% came from buildings, the energy generated to supply those buildings, 36% transportation, and 4% solid waste. So to get those numbers down, you know, what do we need to do? What do we need to do differently in terms of policies? And then this is just something that shows you the idea of climate change is really happening. As part of the planning process that we have on undergoing right now, we're going to be doing future climate projections through 2100, but this basically just shows historical climate data going back to 1960 from the San Antonio International Airport, which shows, yeah, it's been getting warmer. So this isn't something that isn't necessarily happening. And then what do we use for policy direction? And that's sort of where I want to finish up on. The graph on the right really can't see, but basically shows what our community's vulnerabilities are. And the upper right is basically the most highest priority vulnerabilities, and then it basically works its way down to those that are less of a priority. But, you know, the upper right, it's extreme heat and the impact on vulnerable populations. We're talking about flash flooding. How do we start preparing for those? We're already having those conversations about what policies need to come into play to help mitigate those. And then on the left is really what's our pathway to a Paris-compliant plan? How do we reduce our emissions to make sure that when we meet what was committed to as far as our support for Paris, that's how do we make sure that we do not aid in contributing greenhouse gases that are going to bring global climate above 1.5 to 2 degrees Celsius. We already have policies that are in place. You know, as the councilman who just got up was talking about, you know, the Under One Roof program is a great, you know, example of a policy that's aiming at saving energy that is going to help us reduce emissions. CPS's energy conservation program, our tree preservation program, low impact developments.
5 more minutes, Douglas.
Man. Emergency preparedness. I mean, there's lots of policies already that are in place. The key is how do we stitch these together as well as others that are going to get us where we need to go. And so, the idea of how do we get a handle on land use and growth? Well, the planning department's working on a regional center plan. How do we increase density in these key areas? How do we create a better housing and jobs balance so people can live somewhere and work? And then how do we connect these through transportation options? So also, the planning departments and VIA and transportation and capital improvements are looking at what is that next, and as the mayor had basically said, what's that modern transportation system? then what can you do? This is just, there's lots of things out there. It's your own personal choices in terms of mobility and how you live your lives. And again, really the big thing is the first step is speaking up and being part of the conversation. Jump into this essay climate rating conversation. Come to our public meetings, come to steering committee or technical working group meetings, they're all open to the public. Volunteers, that's the big thing we're looking for. We need people to get out to the community and talk to folks and make sure they're aware of this, or host your own meeting. And then really think about why are we doing this? These are my kids. Yeah, I look at them, I think about what's the future that's in store for them. That, you know, it may not seem like it's a huge issue now, but if we look in the future, we look at what their kids are going to be facing with, it's the moral imperative of how we make it a reality.
Douglas, our respondent this morning is Ms. Carol Fisher. Thank you, Carol.
Hi, thank you to the sustainability staff and those people from CPS and SAWS for kind of standing on their historical work. When we look at conservation methods that were put in decades ago, but as then there were detractors and now there are two. So our work is really very hard. And the sustainability office and the electives though we can grow, and we have to innovate. We must be compassionate and critical at the same time. We must go beyond tolerance and diversity and reach for inclusion. Last part of this is some homework. I know each and every one of you has a cell phone. If you can take that cell phone out right now, I'm going to part ways with you, and I'm going to leave you 3 minutes in which to do this. If you will dial 311 and send a message to your city council person, if you give
resource aspect of the sustainability plan, particularly from the adaptation side. Food security is a huge issue, because if we start seeing global disruptions in the food system as a result of climate, do we have a local foundation to have as much local food security as possible? So I see that part of the conversation with the climate planning process. And then, I'm not sure, what was the specific question related to the climate projections and drought? I agree, that's a big consideration that we need to look at, but was there a specific question?
I guess it's simply, are the mitigations that have been implemented so far, or in the process of being implemented, have they adequately taken into account these projections? And not just taking in a projection that is median or best case, but actually looking at worst case and how can we mitigate, are we mitigating sufficiently for worst case, and if not, what's going to happen?
Basically, right now we received some of the drafts climate projections from UTSA. We have them out for some peer review, but we'll be releasing those shortly. And so I think that'll spur the conversation to start looking at as far as what those projections show in terms of drought. But I think the intent is to look at different emission scenarios from low to high to make sure that we're also looking at the extreme as well. And then in terms of roofless solar and the community solar, I would maybe at the break, if you can capture Corner Kim Stover, Todd Horseman from CPS, raise your hand, guys. And they could, I'm not sure what the plan is for roofless solar. I think the first phase was completed. I think there's probably an assessment going on right now to determine the effectiveness and whether or not it needs to be tweaked. There is a community solar RFP that's out. That they'll be developing another community solar project, and I think talking to them about that, what you had mentioned, is there an opportunity of selling off those existing assets around mountain solar to see if there's a way of financing new solar projects? I think that's a big suggestion as well.
Carol, do you have any thoughts?
I know that I just noticed there were a couple of students in the back that had a question.
Well, we need to move on.
You can catch us